I am Dr. Maha Ismail, Associate Professor of Biochemistry at Nilean University, Faculty of Medicine, Nilean University. My talk is about prevalence of metabolic syndrome among young Sudanese university students. And here we use the three definitions of metabolic syndrome. We use the WHO, International Diabetes Federation, and National Cholesterol Education Program, ATB3. So first, metabolic syndrome was described very early from 1988 by Revin as a clusters of some risk factors which may later on develop diabetes and cardiovascular disease that include obesity, dyslipidemia, hypertension, and impaired fasting blood glucose. And here we have, these are the three definitions using different parameters. And this is the first one, IDF, NCEP, and WHO. And here they are using, we have used the three parameters. If we can just take a look about the three definitions, the International Diabetes Federation, we diagnose the case as having metabolic syndrome if he has impaired glycemia and any of two others criteria. For example, fasting blood glucose range from 100 to 125, and the waist circumference more than 94 or in males and more than 80 in females, and the triglyceride cholesterol 150 and HDL cholesterol less than 40 and in males and 50 in females. And the patient may have high blood pressure or he is on treatment. The National Cholesterol Educational Program, the diagnosis is confirmed by 3 out of 5 criteria if they are present. If you can see here the difference, the glycemic control here, it is about the same, impaired fasting blood glucose from 110 to 125, but here the waist circumference, it is more, 102 in males and 88 in females. The triacylglycerol is the same and HDL is the same, and the blood pressure is more than 130 over 85. The WHO criteria, the diagnosis of glycemia is abnormal if the patient or the case has abnormal glucose and any of these two criteria. And here, the WHO criteria, they depend on the body mass index, not on the waist circumference. And the systolic blood pressure, can you see it is very high, 160 over 90. And so, in addition to insulin resistance and microalbuminuria. Here, this is the prevalence of metabolic syndrome, the global prevalence, and this is among adults. In our study, we use young adults. As you can see, we have very high rate in Europe. It range between 7 to 36% in males and between 5 to 22 in females. In the USA, about 7%. In China, Hong Kong, range between 5 to 15. In Middle East and Africa, you can see the highest rate in Saudi Arabia, about 39.3, with different range. And here, there is very few study among adolescents and young adults. And here, as you can see, we found only about 4 studies, and the higher rate is in USA, about 12 to 19%, followed by Iran, 10 to 19%, and the least in Japan. Regarding Sudan, there is no study found or have been done regarding this age group. So the aim of our study is to study the prevalence of metabolic syndrome and the other associated risk factor among young Sudanese adults, which are university students. And here we have used the three definitions, the WHO, NCEP, ATB, and IDF. The method is, study design was descriptive, cross-sectional study. And the study area was the Khartoum State, which is the capital of Sudan. And in Sudan, we have about, in the capital, we have more than 15 at that time universities. And here we have chosen 2 public universities and 2 private universities. And the study duration was between 210 and 230. The study population, we chose healthy university students. Males and females were randomly chosen. and as I said, from the 15 public universities. The total sample size was 1,022 students. This is our result. Our result, this is the baseline of our study population. As you can see, the more were females, which represent about 67.8, and in our country, and I think in most of the countries, the most, the percentage of the females were more included in all faculties. And here we have chosen more than one faculties. We have science and even other faculties. So the 67%, 67.8 were females, and the mean age, as you can see, the mean age was 20.7 among males, and there is no significant difference between the mean age between males and females. Regarding the weight, height, and body mass index, and the waist circumference, we realized that males are more, has more overweight and more body mass index and more height than females. And statistically was significant. Here is the prevalence of metabolic syndrome using the three criteria. As you can see, the rate is highest by using IDF criteria, which about 8.4%. And the least by using the WHO, which is 6.1, and the NCEP is about 7.5%. Here, the different parameters used in diagnosis of metabolic syndrome. As you can see here, here we have the low HDL. As you can see here, by NCEP, about 40% of the students have very low HDL cholesterol. And when we use the WHO, it represents only 17.4%. And then here, the triacylglycerol is the same because they have the same criteria, which is 150 milligram. And here, regarding the waist circumference, can you see the IDF because it has less parameter, it used less measurement or RESI scale. So here, 23.6. Percent of the students were considered to are obese or overweight. Here we use, this is the abdominal obesity and the body weight also using the three criteria. Here we have the WHO, the NCEP and IDF. If you can see by using the WHO to correlate or to detect the abdominal obesity. Here about the WHO rely mainly on the body mass index. So, and the waist hip ratio. If you can see by the body mass index, we have about 3.1 for the all subject are obese, which the body mass index more than 30. And if we use the waist hip ratio, it is about 10.4. By using the NCEP, ATP, it is 8.9. And here, if you can detect by IDF, we have 23.6 from our group are obese. So we have different statistical value. Here, what about the blood pressure and hypertension? Also, there is different rating. Then, as you can see here, by using the NCEP and IDF criteria, it said every person who have more than 130 over 85 is at risk. And here our group, 15.6 of our students have high blood pressure, according to this criteria. If we come to the WHO, only 9.7 are hypertensive. According to the Joint National Committee, the pre-hypertensive among our group were 13.5, and the hypertensive were 9.7. And here is the prevalence of impaired fasting blood glucose, also by using the three parameters. If you can see here, the fasting blood glucose using NCEP, which more than 110, we have 8.1% of the students have high blood glucose, and according to IDF, it is more than 100, so 11.3% of the student has impaired blood glucose. Here our lipid profile, and as we can see, all the three parameters have the same value regarding a triglyceride, three parameter. So regarding our subject, about 8.4% have high level of triglyceride. And regarding the HDL cholesterol, in the WHO has lower level than the IDF and NCP, so about 17.4% has impaired HDL or low level of HDL. While using the other parameter here, it is not clear here, I think, we have higher level, but it is not, I don't think it can. Forty point seven have low level of HDLC, high density, low cholesterol level. And here we correlate this metabolic parameters of metabolic syndrome component in addition to physical inactivity. In our questionnaire, there was some question about their physical inactivity. And as you can see here, we have negative correlation, significant in some items with fasting blood glucose and blood pressure and body mass index and triglyceride and HDL. So there is negative correlation between physical activity and these parameters. In our study also, we asked about the prevalence of smokers among the students. And as you can see here, we found, yes, we found that the smoker, for the first time, we consider that if you can, 7% of the smokers are females. You can see, and 10% were males. 17% of the group are smokers, and from them, there are 7% are females. Regarding physical activity also in our questionnaire, if you can see that more than half of the group, they don't practice any exercise. And about one-third of them, 37.6, they have exercise, but on irregular behavior, and only 9.3 are exercising on a regular basis. Here the percentage of some of the lifestyle, and here we ask about taking soft drinks, and if you can see here, more than one-third of them consume more than 3 liters per week of soft drinks. And we ask about the snacks, 75.5% have snacks, and about sitting in the computer and sleeping hours. And here you can see watching TV, more. We ask about less than 3 hours and more than 3 hours, 25% they sit on the TV more than 3 hours. And regarding computer, 23.7% use computer more than 3 hours per day. And the sleeping hours, more than half of them or less, about 50%, they sleep about 8 to 9 hours per day. So in our conclusion, the conclusion of our result is, as I say, this is the first study to be done in Sudan regarding metabolic syndrome and its risk factor regarding this group, which are young adults. High prevalence of metabolic syndrome and its component were detected among Sudanese young university students. Metabolic syndrome is not limited to industrialized countries. We are developing countries, but there is a major change in our lifestyle and eating habits. So I think this is a very high prevalence regarding our country. And also we realized the low HDL cholesterol level were the main prevalent risk factor. And the burden of abdominal obesity among Sudanese young people is of concern. And waist circumference is more indicative than the body mass index. High prevalence of hypertension, pre-hypertension, diabetes, and pre-diabetes was detected among this age group. Gender disparity, we found that most of the risk factor were more in males, was main player, and sex hormone at young age are of concern in metabolic abnormalities. Contrary to what is known in Sudan community, many females to find to be smokers. And the incidence of inactivity among university students in Sudan increased towards more sedentary lifestyle. So our recommendation was to identify and control existing risk factors such as abdominal obesity, low HDL cholesterol at early age for assessment and prevention, and to join our findings for new or ongoing planning for health service and program of future non-communicable prevention and control, and to create aggressive management of metabolic syndrome for primary prevention of cardiovascular disease, particularly other measures to increase the HDL cholesterol, and to reevaluate cutoff point of body mass index among Sudanese males, especially because we realize that males are more, to develop college health program that promote healthful behavior, including increasing physical activity, eating balanced diet, and avoidance of adult weight gain, and to initiate study programs investigating the impact of physiological aspect at this age, particularly sex hormones, on the progression of metabolic syndrome risk factor on one hand, and on the other. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Maha, for the nice presentation. If anyone has a question, Dr. Maha? I have a question myself. So do you and your study have looked into the major of the student that you've been evaluated, meaning have you ever looked to see what is the major, where there are medical school or in the, like the major for the student that you have been evaluating for metabolic syndrome? What is their major and what they are studying in the university?
Studying different, we didn't concern on different faculty, but different, we take it randomly from different faculties. We have faculty of medicine, engineer, agriculture, different faculties we didn't concern. We have another study, but I didn't show that another result. We didn't find significant difference between difficult. We thought, I don't know if you mean stress.
No,
we find no significant difference between difficult faculties. Okay. And even, as I said, we choose two public and two government because we thought about socioeconomic.
Sure.
But even for this, we didn't find any significant difference.
Yeah, it will be interesting because a physician or medical student should be advocate and should be a model for the other university student. It will be just interesting to know exactly. Although, like, there has been many studies regarding the academic achievement, that's obese individual, unfortunate. They have better academic achievement compared to the normal individual. And I myself did a study in the elementary school and found that obese, they tend to have better academic achievement. I think because they're lacking for exercise and spending most of their time studying at home. But I just wondering if there was a difference.
Thank you for the nice presentation. I have a question about the three methods that you have used. One is the WHO, National Diabetes Federation, and the other one. I've seen that there is a huge discrepancy between the methods, and you, I don't know how you based your conclusions, based on all of them together, like the median of this, or you based your conclusions based on one, you choose one, because there is a slight difference between the methods and the criteria of these methods.
Yes,
that we
understand. Use the three criteria. We use, for example, you see the difference between the WHO and the IDF and ATP, for example, in the glucose level and in in body mass index. WHO, they use the body mass index and waist tip ratio. In IDF, they use the waist circumference. So we use each criteria, for example, WHO for the whole group, and we see how many percent fulfill the criteria of the WHO, and how many percent fulfill the criteria of the IDF, and how many percent fulfill the criteria of NCP.
For example, our blood pressure, there is quite
different.
A big difference between the two methods. Which one you took? The one that is higher, like in terms of IDF, or the other ones that they are slight lower.
If you remember the slide of the hypertension, I have presented two, the three methods. Mm-hmm. Two are the same, and one is different. The WHO is different. So I present here the three parameters for the measurement of hypertension or the level of the hypertension. Okay. And that's my question here. If you want to detect metabolic syndrome, which method we can use? Because if you can see the prevalence percent is different according to different methods. And we have highest in the IDF. If we use IDF, we have high level. And the least is the WHO. So if we want, now we have a study to detect metabolic syndrome for any population, which method is more sensitive to use? That's our message maybe in this conference. Which was it? We have used the three methods, and we have different results, and we have extreme, maybe one have low result and the other is medium and high. So which one we can use if we want to use only one method? Because this is very difficult, really. Statistically, we spend a lot of time because each group we fulfill the criteria for each one for the whole 1,000 students. And then we use the three criteria. But now I'm asking in this conference which one we can use, and we are confident that this is the accurate percent or prevalence of metabolic syndrome among the group.
Now, if you are, for example, if you are recommending some, you know, programs or action need to be taken based on these methods that you have used, which one you are recommending to build your reaction? I mean, if there is any program, are they going to consider the IDF or mix of all of them, or which, based on your study, which one
for me,
should be
I
taken in consideration?
IDF, because here it used the waist circumference, and I think it is more sensitive than body mass index.
Thank you.
By adding a whole number of factors, people have created confusion in terms of what is a metabolic syndrome, because it's really not very well defined, except that if you have three risk factors, put them under a syndrome. But basically, if you look at, just as you have understood, hip-waist ratio, that adequately explains that most of them with a higher ratio are under metabolic syndrome. So simplest that we use is the hip-waist ratio to identify, not necessarily going through any of these guidelines, which are confusing. And secondly, by and large, the treatment is based on the risk factors at this point. And that's what is taken into account, because there is no such thing as treating a metabolic syndrome, yes, because it's a complex thing.
Thank you, Dr. Amaha, for the nice presentation.